always happens like it does. Even though I know we're only here for a while, how come it never seems like long enough? I don't know just when my time is coming. Still I know God has a plan for me. I don't know what meaning looks like, but I know this. You won't have to wonder where I'll be. I know I'll be there in that place that Jesus promised He would prepare. It's beyond imagination, all the glories we will share, and I know. I don't know what kind of mansion God's preparing. Streets of gold I know I'm gonna find. All the pain and suffering that comes in this life, it won't be long, I'll leave it all behind. I know I'll be there in that place that Jesus promised He would prepare. It's beyond imagination, all the glories we will share, and I know I'll be there. I know my name is written. I know that I've been covered by His blood. And I believe, I know I'll be there in that place that Jesus promised He would prepare.
Established church, the leaders didn't feel like you could know that. They put a lot of emphasis on works, and your good works have to outweigh your bad works, and therefore, then you could have eternal life. But like Brother James saying, you know, it's for the Christian, it's just the fact that you know, and I know, that I will be there, and you know that you will be there. And so, I think that's one of the blessings that God gives a born-again Christian, a true Christian, is the fact that he can know. And my friend, if you don't know today for sure that you have eternal life, then I would encourage you to find Jesus today. Amen. Andrew Blackwood, who was a preacher many years ago, he was a teacher of preachers. And he said there are two kinds of sermon. Now, in seminary, we learned there are several different kinds of topical, textual, expository. But he said there are two kinds of sermons. There are those who are looking for God. That's one kind of sermon. Then there are those who have found God. That's another kind of sermon. So that's the kind of sermon I want to preach today to you who are Christians. And if you are not, I would encourage you to close this service. We're going to give you an opportunity to make that decision to follow Jesus. But if you would, turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 18, and we're going to talk about compelled to compassion. Matthew chapter 18, and if you would, look down to verse 21. Matthew chapter 18 and verse 21, and we're going to talk about compelled to compassion. Matthew 18 and verse 21. Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me, and I forgive him? Till seven times? And Jesus said unto him, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven. Therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened to a certain king, which would take an account of his servants. And when he began to reckon, one was brought unto him, which owed him 10,000 talents. And I have a little footnote in my Bible that said, that's several $1,000,000. He owed him that much money. But for as much as he had not to pay, his Lord commanded him to be sold, and his wife and his children, and all that he had, and payment to be made. And the servant therefore fell down and worshipped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay thee all. Then the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion, and loosed him, and forgave him the debt. But the same servant went out, and found one of his fellow servants, which owed him 100 pence, and that's anywhere from a few dollars to a couple of $100s. Quite a bit less. And he laid his hands on him and took him by the throat and saying, pay me that thou owest. And his fellow servant fell down at his feet and besought him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay thee all. And he would not, but went to cast him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what was done, they were very sorry and came and told unto the Lord all this that was done. Then his Lord, after they had called the man unto him, said unto him, O thou wicked servant, I forgave thee all thy debt, because thou desirest me. Shouldst not thou also have had compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? And his Lord was wroth, and delivered him to the tormentors, till he should pay all that was due unto him. So likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you, if ye from your hearts forgive not every one his brother their trespasses. So that's what I want to talk about today. This would be a message probably we could classify to those who are Christian. But realize this, you know, God can speak to us through any portion of His Word. And so I would encourage you, if there's any decision you need to make, you be thinking about that today. And during our service, asking the Lord to help you make the right decision. We all agree that our times are changing. And certainly with the technology we have today, it just seems like there are so many changes that come almost instantaneously. We look around us and things that we buy today are obsolete or outdated tomorrow. And so we just understand that that's just the way a lot of this is. One of the ways that we can say that we've changed is in our choices or in our options. I mean, we have so many options today. I think that makes it hard for us to make a choice. I mean, Henry Ford, when he began the mass production of the automobile, he said you could have any car, any color car, as long as it was black. And there weren't a lot of choices. And so now today we have all colors of cars. I mean, there are several different kinds of just the color red. You got candy red, fire engine red, carmine red. So we have all these choices today. And because of that, it makes it hard to make a good choice. I mean, we present so many options. The same is true in our Christian life. I mean, not only is it just right and wrong, there seem to be so many in-between issues today. So many what-ifs and different scenarios, you know. And it's oftentimes it makes what God's Word says to us kind of confusing. Well, you know, the Bible doesn't deal with, we think, certain topics. And maybe we think that God would deal with this a certain way if he was faced with the dilemmas that we are faced with today. So with all the changes that we have, and with all the different things and options that we have today, I mean, it's hard to know and it's hard to make the right choice. And one of the problems, because of all these choices and the way things have changed today, in a lot of cases, we have lost our ability to be compassionate, to have compassion. I mean, you think about it, the way things come at us today. And you think about how that, you know, we are encouraged that if God speaks to our heart and there's a sacrifice that we need to make, and yet we have so many of these other options that we can pawn off onto one of those places, and we don't have to address it directly or deal with it directly. And so one mistake that we've made today is that we have began to try to accept and embrace and condone, maybe not even realizing what is wrong in our society. You know, if we talk about something that's wrong, or if we talk about sin, we are labeled as someone who is not compassionate. If we are against anything, then we're labeled with the idea of being someone who's filled with hate. Now you cannot pass a law to make me love you. You know what I'm saying? You just can't do it. You cannot force me to think like you would like for me to think. In other words, if I hate you, there is nothing you can do, really, to keep me from hating you. And so why is it so important for us to be compassionate? Because if we want to change that way of thinking, then we're going to need the Lord's help. And that's what I want us to understand. Our society does not realize that. If you really want to change a man, you need to change him from within. And that only comes through the help of Christ. Only Jesus can really change people. And so one of the things I want to talk about today is that we are compelled as Christians to have compassion. And it just seems like because we see so much today, so much evil, and so much taken advantage of, that we have trouble reaching out and being compassionate. Now one of the things we want to do is make sure that inside these four walls of the church building, it's okay to be compassionate. It's easy, perhaps easier for us to be compassionate. But Jesus wants us to go outside these four walls as a Christian and show compassion. And that's where we oftentimes run into trouble. In fact, you think about this. We've tried to do that as a Christian and as a Christian society, or as Christians in society, we have tried to do that. We have turned the other cheek. We have gone the extra mile. We have given them our cloak when we were compelled to give them our coat. We have, the Bible says, we have loved those that hate us. We have prayed for our enemies. The last refuges that we have in public life, you know, we look outside, we see businesses and places that, you know, are still claiming to be Christian. And we look at those as, okay, those are places that we can participate and be a part of. And in today's society, we are compelled to give up those. And so now we say, well, now, Lord, haven't we been compassionate? What else can we do? I mean, we've done all we can do. We've given everything we have. And now you still want to talk about compassion. The world hates Christ. And the world hates Christians. And Jesus still wants us to be compassionate towards those people. The Bible says in 1 John, look at 1 John chapter 2 and verse 15. It's going to be familiar when you get there. But look at 1 John. That's over towards the back of the book, right before Revelation, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. But 1 John chapter 2 and 15, look at what God says. Look at what He says. He says, 1 John 2 and 15, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Now, what does God tell us in 1 John? He says, we are not to love the world. But when you get to John 3:16, the Bible says, for God so loved the world. And yet He tells us not to love the world. Now when you look at the word love, it's the same word in both places. It's a sacrificial love. And when you look at the word world, It's the same word in both places. It means cosmos. It's the system, the world system, the world's opinions, the world's philosophy. And God tells us that He tells us not to love the world, and yet He says He loved the world. And so what's the difference? Why would God tell us not to love the world, and He loves the world? Let me tell you something. The difference is, it's really in the sacrifice. God loved the world, agape love, and so He sacrificed. What did He sacrifice because He loved the world? He sacrificed His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. What a better picture of love can we have than this? And yet the Bible tells us not to love the world. Why? Because our sacrifice, when we love the world, we sacrifice what is good and holy and righteous and acceptable in God's sight. You see what I'm saying? So God's sacrifice is different. He sacrificed because of His love for the world. He sacrificed the most precious thing to Him, His Son. When we sacrifice because of our love for the world, we sacrifice as a Christian what is good. When we love the world, what do? We quit going to church, we quit reading our Bible, we quit praying, we start getting involved in sin, we disobey God. That's a sacrifice that we make. And so you see there's a difference. And so when we talk about compassion, we have to understand that compassion is more than just what's on the outside. Compassion has to be, as a Christian, it has to be in our heart. It's not just in the things that we do. And we read the story in the story of the Good Samaritan. We see Jesus gave a perfect example of a person who loved his neighbor. Now the religious people, they didn't love their neighbor. In fact, Jesus said they didn't love anyone but themselves. But the priest and the Levite had an opportunity to express love and compassion to a man that was, you know, wounded and almost, he was half dead, and they chose not to show compassion. Someone else comes along and, you know, they're willing to, not even the same ethnicity, the same race, whatever. He was a Samaritan, and yet he was willing to show compassion. And so it's not really an outward thing, because the Pharisee, the priest and the Levite, They looked around to make sure no one was looking. And they chose not to have compassion. And the Samaritan, he didn't care. He just saw a man that had a need, a man that was hurt, a man that was about to die, needed medical attention, and he just had compassion. And he didn't care who was looking on. He didn't care what kind of audience he had. He didn't worry about the repercussions, you know. He just went and did what God had called any Christian, any of His children to do. Let me share four things from our passage right now about being compelled to compassion. The first thing I want to share with you is found in our passage, and it talks about Christ-like compassion is long-suffering. Now, what is Peter? He comes to the Lord, and he said, Lord, he said, and I'm sure, like us, Peter was, he had someone in mind, you know what I'm saying? It wasn't just a hypothetical. Peter was probably thinking about somebody that, you know, he had tried to help, and they kept coming back, and, you know, offending and asking forgiveness. So probably Peter had somebody in mind. He said, Lord, how many times do I have to forgive my brother? Seven times? And Jesus said, no, Peter, I want you to have the attitude, the heart of compassion, to forgive him 70 times seven. Now, what's 70 times seven? Right quickly. 490, is that correct? And so after 490 times, which most of us wouldn't have lasted near that long, is it okay not to forgive on that 491st time? That's not what the Lord's coming. He said, Peter, I want you to forgive every time someone comes and asks forgiveness. Why? Because this is Christ-like compassion. You know, we hear about things like tough love. And we say things like, well, you know, he's made his bed, let him lie in it. We say things like, well, I've tried to help him, and this is all I can do. And so we'll go so far. But I think all of us have the point that enough is enough. And that's our attitude. And that is not really a heart of compassion. Now, granted, we cannot, you know, encourage people, enable people to continue in sin. But we're talking about asking forgiveness and showing forgiveness. And that's what the Lord's talking about to Peter right here. And so we need to be patient. And And that's what compassion, it's patient. You know, some of the problems that some people have, you know, we think, well, you just, you know, we got so many problems, that you just take a pill, and brother, you're cured. And a lot of times we think it's that way with some of the situations in life. But not everybody is as strong a Christian as you are. People have lived so long in the world and so long affected by the world, you know, it may take several times. Now, I know Jesus, he does miracles in our life all the time. And he can change a man. I mean, one day he can be a down in the gutter sinner. Next day he's a, you know, perfect saint. But I'm just saying, you know, we need to be compassionate. You know, we need to, if it's possible, to put ourselves in these people's, in their situation sometimes. But we have a hard time. You know, I remember, this keeps coming up, and I've used it several times, but I believe, what was the hurricane that hit New Orleans so bad? Was it Katrina? Katrina, that was several years ago, if you remember. And we got a little backlash from that, too. But I remember on television, of course, you just got to watch out there, but I remember, you know, the TV crews going down in the area of New Orleans, and they went by I guess it's the Superdome, is the big Coliseum or stadium where they used to play the Super Bowl. And they had set up that building as a shelter. And I can imagine what it must have been like inside that building. It was so, you know, the weather was so bad, it was hot, and crammed in those, and certainly in our time with the pandemic, you know, it would have been impossible, but all, you know, hundreds of people. And I remember the TV crews driving by the Superdome and people standing outside. And they approached the TV crews and with hatred in their hearts and their voices, and they were screaming and hollering for all the world to know, send us some food. We are hungry. We're starving. Send us some food. You know, and people from Texas and people from all over the United States were sending help, and there was help on the way. But I thought about those people that were screaming and demanding to be given food. And then I noticed something interesting. Almost all of them weighed 400 pounds. You know, they were huge. And I thought, my goodness, you know, they're hungry, they're starving, and look at how big they are. Look at how overweight they are. And granted, you know, a salad would have been better than a dozen donuts, but I'm just thinking, you know, fat people got to eat too. But, I saw these people, you know, they don't need food. They need exercise. They need a treadmill, you know. But the thing is, that's the attitude of compassion. And that's an attitude of lack of compassion. We think we know what they need. And oftentimes it keeps us from helping or from showing compassion or from giving like we should. And giving people what they want is not always the best thing. But, you know, we still need to have compassion. A second thing I noticed in our passage, Christ-like compassion is reciprocal. And what I mean by this is, you know, here's a man who owed millions of dollars, and he went to the Lord or the master or whatever, the banker, you can say, and he said, I can't pay it, would you? He said, I'll pay it, just give me time. And what did the Bible says the master or the Lord had compassion. And he said, don't worry about it. Here's a timesheet. You can pay. He said, don't worry about that. He said, I forgive the debt. I mean, here's a man. He goes to him. He falls down. He begs for mercy. He begs for compassion. And the man says, okay, your debt is forgiven. Go in peace. I'm giving you a clean slate. Well, this same man who'd been forgiven, he goes, and one of his fellow servants owed him a few dollars. And the Bible says he got upset, took him by the throat. He said, you pay me what you owe me. And he said, I'll have compassion, be patient, I'll pay you. And he wouldn't do it. Had him thrown into prison. He had all of his goods confiscated, you know, even affected his family. And so what happened was, this man's fellow servants went and told the Lord, or the master, what, to listen, this is what's happened. And the Bible says he was so angry he called in the servants, and you know, he said, I showed compassion upon you, and I forgave you a debt of thousands, maybe even millions of dollars, and you're not willing to forgive your fellow servant a debt of just a few dollars. He said, you can change the outcome, you can change the verdict, you're going to be thrown into prison. No mercy, no compassion. And so what I want you to understand is, I think, and the Bible talks about this, if we don't forgive, we're not forgiven. Amen. If we're not willing to show compassion, compassion won't be shown to us. So it's the idea, you know, we can't expect to we want forgiveness and we want compassion, but then we're not willing to give it. We're not willing to extend it. I think about Elisha in the Syrians. When Elisha was the prophet, of course, you know, he came along after Elijah. He had just as much power from the Lord and did many miracles, Elisha. And the Bible says that Elisha, the Syrians were always battling with the Israelites at this time. And there was a Syrian, he was captain of the host, he was the number one general. His name was Naaman. And the Bible says he had leprosy. Well, he heard about a man in Israel, a prophet who could help him. And of course, he came about through the help of Naaman's little servant maid. So he goes down, and you know, Elisha didn't even come out. He sends his assistant, and tells Naaman, said, "You need to dip in the Jordan River 7 times, and you'll be cleansed." Of course, Naaman was upset. He didn't want to do it. That's just there were plenty of rivers in Syria. Why did he have to come all the way down here? But he did. And he was healed. And Naaman was so grateful and so thankful, he wanted to give Elisha a gift, a present, money and clothes and whatever. But Elisha said, no. He said, I'm not going to do that. And so, you know, they part their separate ways. Well, Elisha's servant, Gehazi, he gets to thinking, you know, Elisha, he was a little bit hasty. He should have taken something from this man. So Gehazi, Elisha's servant, runs him down and says, hey, well, my master's changed his mind. He wants some money and some silver and some gold and maybe some new clothes. And of course, Naaman said, oh, well, here, fine, take it. Take this. Take more, you know. Take plenty. And so Gehazi's got this, you know, this bag of money and these new clothes, and he's rushing home to hide them in his room. Well, Elisha being the prophet of the Lord. Let me tell you something. If you're working for the prophet of the Lord, you better be careful what you're sneaking around doing. But Gehazi, he thinks out of it, well, Elisha doesn't remember. And he didn't even see it with his own eyes. And so he calls him in and he begins to question. He said, does he ask his servant Gehazi, is this a time to take money? God has watched over us. He's protected us. He's provided for us. You know, when our enemies could have taken advantage of us, we could have been injured or hurt. And, you know, is this really a time to take advantage of our enemies? And of course, you know, the curse or the judgment that came upon Gehazi was that the leprosy that was on Naaman fell upon Gehazi. The next portion of that same chapter, we find once again Elisha and his, perhaps it's a new servant, they're hiding out in a certain town with a band of Syrians are looking for them. They want to execute Elisha because every time they make a plan to attack Israel, their plan is found out because Elisha knows about it, and he tells the king of Israel, don't go to this place or let's flee this place, you know. And so they're looking for Elisha, and they find out where he is. So they surround the city. And Elisha's servant comes out, and he sees all the Syrian army. And he goes and tells Elisha, we're in trouble. He said, we're surrounded. And, of course, Elisha, he's not worried. He said, Lord, open his eyes. And so, you know, what happens is the servant of Elisha, the prophet of God, his eyes are open. He sees the Syrian army surrounding the city, but he also sees the host of the Lord. And these are angelic hosts that are surrounding the Syrian army. And what happens is God strikes the Syrians with blindness. And Elisha comes, the servant comes, and they're talking to the Syrians. Of course, they're blind. And they said, the man you're looking for, he's in this city, so follow us. And so they take the Syrians right downtown into the capital city of Israel. And these men are blind. And then God takes away their blindness, and they're right in the city of Israel, the Samaria, the capital, surrounded by the Israelite army. And the king of Israel says, Elisha, isn't it time for us to just wipe these people out? And Elisha said, this is not the time for that. This is not the time to execute and to imprison. Here's what you need to do. You give them something to eat. Give them something to drink. Allow them to be refreshed. And then allow them to go home. And the Bible says after that happened, these bands, which were raiding bands of Syrians, they didn't come back against the people of Israel. And so what I want you to understand, the Israelites have been shown compassion. God had protected them and delivered them. Why in the world would they want to, you know, hurt their enemy when God had watched over them? And so this is what I'm trying to say today. You know, God has shown us compassion. The fact that He even saved us when we were not, you know, worthy to be saved. That He showed compassion. And many times He shows us compassion, provision, protection, you know. And then when we have the opportunity to reciprocate and do that for someone else who asks forgiveness or asks compassion, all of a sudden our hearts turn to stone. We've been taking advantage of, oh, we know this time, we know these people, we know they just go around from church to church today, we know that they're just going to take it, we know their attitude about this, you know. And so if we're not careful, we fall into that trap without compassion. The third thing that I would say, Christ-like compassion is, believe it or not, emotional. Now, in that verse, the Bible, in the first verse where the Bible uses the word compassion, which we see is in, where is that scripture? It's in, when he said, verse 27, then the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion. And that word compassion there, in the original language, is the word for bowels. In fact, you can look at the word and you can see the word spleen in there, even though they didn't use that in the New Testament. But it's the word for bowels. And so it's the idea of moved with compassion. Bowels of mercy. It's the idea, you know, that we have a yearning to heaven. It's the idea, emotional idea, that brings tears to our eyes. First time I saw Old Yeller, I'm glad it was in a dark theater. You know what I'm saying? Because man or woman, boy or girl, to me, you can't watch Old Yeller without shedding a tear. And in fact, it's hard for me to watch that show with my family because I know that, you know, of course, at the end of that you realize they shot that dog. And the boy that loved that dog had to shoot him. And so it's just a, you know, a horrible story. It has a good ending, I suppose. But, you know, it's that idea of compassion. Sometimes, especially guys, it's hard for us to show compassion and to be compassionate because we think it's a sign of weakness, isn't it? We think that we just... In fact, I was years ago when I was a course guy, I thought I wanted to get a hunting dog. And I checked around, you know, and I found a guy that he had some hunting dogs and he was selling them. And so I got me a book on raising and training hunting dogs. And it said when you go pick out the puppy, when you go to the, where are we going to get it? There's a litter of puppies. It said, don't take your wife. Why would you not want to take your wife to pick out your dog, especially if you're going to spend a lot of money? Well, the thing is, the wife goes and she looks at the litter, 7-8 puppies, and which one is she going to pick? The runt. The one that nobody's playing with, nobody loves. He's just an outcast. None of the other dogs are playing with him. And so that's the dog you don't want when you're going to get a hunting dog. Because he can't train. He's just going to be lazy and, you know, self-pity and everything else. And so I realize that's not always true. But so we have the idea that women are more sensitive, are more compassionate than men. Therefore, we don't want to show men, that is, we don't want to show compassion. And because of that, fear of showing compassion, it causes us sometimes, believe it or not, not have compassion. Think about that. The Bible says Jesus went to the tomb of his friend Lazarus. Now, he was 4 days getting there. And his sisters thought that he should have come when they first heard that Lazarus was sick. But he waited. So he shows up, Lazarus is dead, people are mourning and weeping and grieving, including his sisters. And so, you know, they're like, Lord, if you'd have been here, our brother wouldn't have died. And the Bible says Jesus saw these people mourning and grieving and weeping, and the shortest verse in the Bible, you can quote it, what does it say? Jesus what?
Wept.
Now, he was about to raise Lazarus from the dead, and I think he knew that. But what I'm saying, when he saw the people, he saw their pain, he saw their hurt, Jesus wept. And it wasn't fake. It wasn't fake tears. It was honest, true sympathy and empathy with the people that had a loss. And that's what compassion is. Sometimes, because we are Christians, sometimes because we think we've sacrificed and suffered so much, we don't want to show compassion. You know, somebody has a need, and we, you know, some of you, and I can say some of us, but some of you, have had it so good that you think you are good. You know what I'm saying? You go to the doctor and you have a cold or a sickness or a disease, and you go to the doctor, he examines you and does some tests. Oh, I know exactly what this is. We're going to give you a shot. We're going to give you some surgery. Boom, and you'll be good to go. Some of us go to the doctor and he says, oh, that's interesting. That kind of perplexed, you know. I haven't seen that before. You know, and so it's not that your doctor's better than my doctor, but I'm just saying, you know, what I have is maybe worse than what you have. And so you look at me or I look at you and I think, you know, we don't want to have compassion. You brought this on yourself. Some of you have a little financial problem. All you do is move some money around. Some of us have financial problems and we move. You know what I'm saying? And so you got to be careful. But what I want to encourage you, as a Christian, we need to have compassion. And this is not something I should have to convince you of. This should come from within the heart of a Christian, a born-again Christian, who's following Jesus Christ. You watch those commercials, you see those people, maybe I pass you on the street, you know, like, can you help us? Can you help, you know, the women's children? Can you help abused children? Can you help the sick dogs? And the list goes on and on and on. And they try to appeal to our compassion. And we get so much of that, we learn to say, we get that hard shit. And we learn to say no before the question is even asked. You get a call on the phone. And I'm an expert at this. You get a call on the phone, and I get 3 or 4 of these calls every day. A lot of you answer the phone, and nobody's on the line. Hello, 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 hello. You know, and nobody, so you know. You get another call, just a quick 1-minute survey question. And I'm thinking, I bet I can hang up this phone quicker than you can ask the question. You know, we know. And so when you answer the phone and somebody doesn't maybe say hello or how you doing, Robert, or whatever, you know, I got a call from the Social Security the other day. They said, I'm in trouble. My number has been stolen. It's been used. They're going to press charges. And they don't even know my name. And they're telling me they're going to come get me. They're going to arrest me. And I have fun. Well, come ahead. Bring it on. Bring it on. But you know, we get those every day. So we learn to be hard. We learn to be, you know, to have that defense. And so when there's a true need, a real need, man, we're not gonna extend the hand. We're not gonna help. And so Christian compassion, believe it or not, is emotion. This man, he saw that man was begging him to forgive the debt. He saw him. He saw the plea in his voice. That touched his heart, and he said, "Man, you're forgiven." Now it's hard to decipher and discern what's real need and what's not. We have so many imposters coming at us today. And I pray for wisdom, I pray for discernment in those situations. But you know, if we keep saying no to everybody that comes along, sooner or later we're going to say no to someone who really needs help from the church or from us as a Christian. So just be careful. And don't let the fear of emotions, of having emotions, upset. The fourth thing I would tell you, Christ-like compassion is merciful. The second word, I believe it's in verse 33 for compassion, is a word, it can be divine or human. So it's the word for mercy. And that's what the master was telling me, the unjust or the unholy servant was. I had compassion on you. You should have had compassion on your fellow servant. And the word there is a word for mercy. And the word can mean human or divine. So, I mean, it can be a person having mercy or it can be God having mercy. It's the same word. And so what I think God's trying to tell us here is that the Christian, Christ-like compassion is exactly that. It is divine. It's God. And so when we choose not to do that, then we are acting in an unholy or an ungodly manner. When we choose to let our feelings of you know, anger or not being taken advantage of override what God has given us in our heart, the heart of compassion. The Bible says, he who knows to do good and doesn't do it, to that man it is sin. And so when our heart touches us, or maybe it's so hard that it doesn't, but in that situation, it's a sin for us to not show compassion. And I'm not saying it doesn't mean we, you know, give everything that we're asked to give. It doesn't mean that we supply somebody with in fact, when Peter and John were going to the temple to pray, a man came, he was crippled, and he was begging for financial means. And so like everybody that came to the temple, he asked Peter and John, you know, can you give me some money? I'm crippled. And Peter said, well, he said, we don't have silver and gold, but what we do have, we're going to give it to you. He said, in the name of Christ, stand up. And the man was healed. Well, that meant he could go and get a job. He could work. He didn't have to beg anymore. So what I'm saying is, a lot of people come to us, and maybe they're asking for a dollar or two, and yet what they really need and what we can really give them is Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying we shouldn't give them the money, because sometimes we need to. And sometimes that's the way we can show Christ. It's not a cop-out for not doing, you know, helping in a material way. But the thing is, I mean, that's what we need the most. Amen? Whether you're poor or rich, it's Jesus Christ. And so as a Christian, God compels us to be compassionate. And I admit, in the days that we live in, it's hard. It's so, because a lot of people are hurting, and we can't help everybody is one of our excuses, you know, or these people are taking advantage of the situation, and if we're not careful, we'll fall into a trap as a Christian where we don't have any compassion like the Bible says we should have. And I want to remind all of us today that if it wasn't for the compassion of Christ, all of us would be eternally lost and bound for hell. Jesus did not save us because we're good. He did not save us because we're better than somebody else. He saved us because He loved us. The Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And that's all. At the foot of the cross, we are all equal. So what I'm trying to explain today is that we as Christians need compassion. And you know, we as Christians, and we as people in America at least, sometimes we have a hard time asking for help. And we tell people, all right, if you need, you know, we said, if you need anything, you just call. And we hope they don't. If you need anything, if you need it, you call me, and I'll be there. But we hope they don't call us. And so what I want to tell you today is that, you know, if that's our attitude, we better check what's going on inside. It's easy for us to say, well, you know, to tell somebody else, you need to have compassion. And the Bible says, have compassion. And you shouldn't be judgmental. You shouldn't be critical. And I think this scripture speaks to each of us individually. We need to have compassion. When I was about 15 years old, I started working at a feed store there in Fairfield. And I guess you could say the original man's name was Otis Brown Utley. That was his name. So it was Utley's Feed Store. And of course, they had land and cattle. They'd been in cotton business, you know, they had grocery stores. At this point, they had a big feed store, feed mill, and part of that was a hardware store. But the original owner, Mr. Otis, we called him, his son was Otis Brown II. He was born on Halloween. They called him Spooky. His Otis Brown III, they called him Brownie. And then Brownie had a son IV. They called him Obie. O-B-I-E. But anyway, but Mr. Otis, he was the original. And so he really wasn't my boss. You could say Brownie, the third generation, was my boss. But Mr. Otis would come up to the store. He'd get there about 9 o'clock, just hang around. Had an old car seat sitting on a wooden crate, a wooden pallet, you know. And he'd sit there most of the day and you know, just talk to people and visit, things like that. But about 5 o'clock, he would get his pickup and go home. And he lived probably a mile and a half from the store, just down Main Street, Fairfield, Highway 84, just south of or east of the store. Well, one weekend he was pulled out of his driveway and pulled out from the car, and they hit him. Nobody was hurt, but it tore up the cars, you know, and Mr. Otis was given a ticket, you know. They fussed about him being so old and driving and things like that. But, you know, it's hard to give up that. And all he did was drive to the store and drive home. But it's Highway 84, four lanes. So he asked me, he said, hey, boy, that's what he told me, boy. Hey, boy, come out here and help me get out on this highway. And so he pulled his pickup right to the edge of the driveway of the feed store at the highway. And he sat there, and I'd walk up there, and I'd act like I was talking to him, you know. But I was really looking for traffic. Then he'd turn and say, okay, go. He'd say, go. Well, he'd take off. Pull out about 100, but then he'd drive about 25. And so every day that would happen. And, you know, I knew he felt bad because he caused an accident. His family really fussed at him, but I felt kind of sorry for him, you know. And And so every afternoon, about 5 o'clock, I'd be looking for him. I'd see that little pickup pull up very young, and I'd walk out there, not every day. And not that I had some great amount of compassion, but I felt, I don't know if the word is sorry, but I felt bad because, you know, it's hard for him to give up. And as far as he drove, you know, all he needed was a little help to get out on the highway. He could make it. And I figured I could do at least that. And what I'm saying, sometimes people come to us and we have an opportunity, and all they need is just a little support, a little encouragement. You know what I'm saying? You know what? We look at the old people, and I'm talking to those of us who are a little bit younger. You know, one of these days, we're going to be old. Now, some of us are hoping that, you know, we don't live to be that old, and maybe we'll die and get rid of all that. But, you know, some of us are going to make it to old age. And we're going to need some compassion. We're going to need some support, and we're going to need some help. And I kind of feel like, I don't know, but I kind of feel like if we'll just extend a hand to help folks, maybe, we don't know a sovereign God's will, but maybe there'll be somebody that will help us when we need it. You know, we're going to need somebody to encourage us and tell us, you know, come around and say, hey, listen, it's going to be all right. You know, God's going to take care of us, and God, and I'm going to help you. And so, you know, some of you don't need that. Some of you just, you're a long-range type. You don't have anybody to help you do anything. You've always done yourself. But there's going to come a day when you're going to need some help. And you may be praying that the Lord will let you live that long, but you know what? The Bible says even Peter, when he was young, he made decisions to go where he wanted to go. When he was old, you know, he was told where to go. He was brought places and carried places, sometimes against his will, perhaps. And so this message today is for every Christian about the idea of compassion. And I suspect, like Peter, we say things hypothetically, you know, we really have somebody in mind. And so I would hope today, if God is talking, speaking to your heart, and you know, most of us probably think, well, I wish somebody had compassion on me. You know, I need some help. And Brother Robbie, you know, that's going to help. Well, I have found that a man who has friends, amen, must show himself friendly. So a man or a woman who is compassionate, it's funny because compassion and encouragement are really included with the spiritual gifts. But nowhere is being judgmental of spiritual gift or critical of spiritual gift. And so I would hope we could learn from the Lord's message here about being compassionate, you know. And there are different situations call for different ways to be compassionate. But it comes from your heart. And when someone has a need, and what I'm saying, compassionate, recognize the need before they even ask. And if it comes from your heart, then don't turn a deaf ear when God's speaking to your heart. And for somebody you need to be compassionate. And like I said, if you'll start being that way and start looking for opportunities to be compassionate, help, looking for people's needs and meeting those needs before they even ask, helping some people have a little bit of dignity left in their life, you know, let them include them and let them be a part, I think God will bless you. I think you'll be pleasantly surprised when you get to the end of your life and you won't be one of those old, bitter people who feel like the world has turned their back on you simply because you were compassionate when you end up. You know, one of the greatest things, and I think the greatest areas of compassion that Christ showed to me and showed to you is when he saved us. We didn't deserve it, but he loved us and he saved us. And so I would tell you today, listen, if you've never accepted that and then realized that you do that today. What I'm saying, if you're not a Christian, if you haven't been born again, God is extending the most amount of compassion that anyone could ever show in wanting to save you. Save you when you didn't want it, didn't deserve it. And oftentimes, in our sinful condition, you know, we have rebelled and rejected Christ, and yet he still wants to save us. He still loves us. And then for those of us who are Christian, listen to what God said. We are to be compassionate. And that should come from within. A preacher shouldn't have to get up and try to, you know, make you feel guilty because you're not. that should come from within. And if it's not there, something is wrong. Something is wrong. And I pray. You know, we can't help every situation. But I saw a commercial today of just little kids that had cleft palates. You know, it's just, of course, for $20 a month, you can help them get surgery. And, you know, I can imagine what it would be like for a child to have to go through something like that. Just fearing in their face, horrible. And yet, you know, with some surgery, with the financial help, those kids can live a more normal life. Kids are cruel. And they're not always accepting of each other, especially when you look different. You know, and there are other ways, many ways that we could handle. And I'm not just talking about charity on the television, but I'm talking about in our heart. Things don't move us to compassion because sometimes our heart is so hard, like stone. And I pray it's not that way. But the more we say no, the more we get used to all the pleas and the pitches for money and financial and all these things, we get kind of hard. So I would ask that you ask the Lord to help you today to tender your heart. That you look for ways that you can help somebody. Just, most of us have so many problems, or we think we do, that we feel like we cannot help anybody else. Help anybody else. And yet, you know, when you look at the book of Luke, when a leper comes to Christ, horrible disease. It's still around. They call it Hansen's disease today, but it's still around. But I mean, it was almost a death sentence if you got left. There was really no cure. And if you were cured in Jesus' day, the only way you could be cured is a miracle. But when this man came to Jesus, he was a leper, an outcast. People would not speak to him, would not deal with him. They didn't even want to be around him. You're talking about social distancing. I mean, he had to stand way off several hundred yards and holler, unclean, unclean, and people couldn't come near him. This man came to Christ, and he fell down at Jesus' feet. And what does the Bible say Jesus did? Now, he would tell people crippled to stand up and tell people with a deformed hand to stretch forth the hand. You know what he did to the leper? He touched him. Nobody in their right mind would touch a leper. But Jesus touched him. Why? Because he had compassion. That man, nobody had touched him for years. And the Lord reached out his hand and he touched him. He healed him, but it's the way he did it. He touched him. Because he had compassion. That's all. That's all God wants from us today. It's just to have compassion. Pray with me. Father, we thank you for our time together. And Lord, I just ask that you use this message to touch our hearts, to tender our hearts. Father, show us how we can help. Show us where we can show compassion. Give us a heart to reach out, and even before people ask, but we see a need. Give us a heart to reach out and to meet a need before it's ever made aware or known to us verbally. Pray, Lord, that you would just break our hearts of stone. Help us not to be taken advantage. Help us not to be burned, but God, help us to look and to see with compassion and reach out and help. Lord, we love you. We thank you for what you did on the cross, and we commit all this to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.